Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
And
also with you. Amen. Thank you for that blessing, and we are all blessed to be here this morning. It's a little chilly inside, isn't it?
Yeah.
Our fingers are cold. They're so cold. I thought, Brittany, you play the guitar. I can play the guitar with cold fingers. But when they say cold fingers, warm tones, how does that go?
Warm heart.
Oh, warm heart. My bad. Amen. So as we gather today in the presence of God, we are grateful. Our hearts are warmed because the presence of God is here with us. Amen.
Amen.
As we gather, I invite you to please stand as you're able, or stand in your heart, and let's join in together in this morning's call to worship taken from Psalm 139. Oh Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path, my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Even before the words is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely.
You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I praise you, Lord, for your faith and my heart is saved. Wonderful are your works, and I know your will.
My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven to the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them has yet existed.
How many of you are your thoughts, Lord? How vast is the sum of my days?
I try to count them, and they are more than the sand.
I come to the end, I am still with you.
Amen. Sisters and brothers, I don't know about you, but I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen.
Fearfully and wonderfully made to praise and worship God. Amen?
Amen?
Let's do that this morning as the body of Christ.
Is it a new song?
I think it is.
It's a new song for us, right? Do you think they can learn it? I think they can. Amen?
Thank you.
said that about you.
We can only call ourselves a child of God because you first called us that. You loved us, Lord, enough to give us your Son to call us, Lord, your own. And we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the life that you not only give to us, but speak into our own lives. And we thank you, God, for the ways that you show your power to your church. And for the strength that you give us as your people. And for the ways that you keep holding us and carrying us, walking with us, we give you thanks, Lord. Everything we are is because of who you are. Everything we have is by your holy name. In the power of your Holy Spirit, God, we come here this morning to worship you. To worship you because you are good. To worship you because your love is eternal. And as we come here as your beloved children to worship you, God, may all we do here honor you. Direct our thoughts, Holy Spirit, to the glory of God in these moments, in this time of worship, so that we might be prepared to live in a way, that says our worship of you is true. Thank you, God, for this day, the blessing of another day to worship you and to gather with your church. And all these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thanks be to God. Sisters and brothers, before you sit down, don't go anywhere. Just kind of turn and wave at everybody and say, good morning, God bless you, good to see you. And then you can sit down. Church that is here in sanctuary, would you turn around? You see the exit sign? You may not know this, but right under the exit sign is a camera. All our church family at home, they're watching with us. Would you wave to them and give them the blessing of God? Yell at them too. Amen. I see Mike, and Roy, and Elda, Pam, Yana, Francis, Audra, Emily Canales. Hey, you're in Kingsville. I'm glad you're here too, Emily. Vicky, Father Bruce. I remember Father Bruce. Yeah. Let's see. Lizette says she can't hear. I'll fix that. Amen. Tony, Irene, Adam, my good friend Adam. Deborah Lane. Hi, Mama. That's my mama. Olga. Who else do I see? Olga. That's about it right now. Amen. So good to be able to join together with the church. Amen.
Amen.
And what a blessing it is to gather in His house, His day, as His people, and to know that His presence is with us. Amen. Now I see some hand waving and hellos and hearts and all those other stuff. So, amen. We are thankful to be together. Am I right, church?
Right.
Amen. As we gather together, we gather to worship God. We gather to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, because that is our life. And as the body of church, that's where our attention and our heart needs to be. And so I'm grateful whether you call this church home, yours church home, for as long as you can remember, or whether this is the first time that you are joining us. We give thanks to God for each and every one of you. You are a blessing, and it is a joy to be able to share in this time together. So in just a few moments, I'm going to read to you from John chapter 1 as our sermon text this morning. Before I do, I want to encourage you to, I don't know what you think right before a preacher or anybody else goes to read a scripture. Maybe you're wondering if you can find it in your Bible. Maybe you're thinking it's, you know, maybe they'll read it fast or slow. Maybe it's a passage you'll know. Or I don't know what you think. But whatever you think, would you do me a favor? I'm going to open this word. I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to speak to us through this word. And would you prepare with me in that way in your own mind right now and in your soul? Would you ask the Holy Spirit to inspire us to hear the voice of God through the word of God given to us this morning? Hear these words, church, from John chapter 1. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Sisters and brothers, this is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, help us to hear just what I say, but to hear your voice through what you have given to me. And may all of us, as the body of Christ, as believers, followers of Jesus, after hearing your word proclaimed, be that much closer to fully understanding and loving your holy will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I'm sure I've told you this story before. It's one of those stories that sticks out to me a lot. But I was in church one Sunday, and there was a little boy named Wade, who was part of the church. And at the time, I guess he was probably 6, 7, maybe 8 years old. And Wade had a friend who had spent the night before. And Wade brought his friend to church. Amen? Little Wade brought his friend to church, y'all. I'll leave that alone. But Wade wanted me to meet his little friend, and I could see Wade had a little smile on his face, like, and so he walks up to me. We're in between services, and I'm getting stuff ready, and Wade says, "Pastor John, this is my friend." I forget his name. "This is my friend. He spent the night last night, and he's got this grin on his face." I'm like, "Okay." He says, "He thinks church is boring." I tell him, "Wade, so do I." So I was thinking about that this week in relation to our text this morning, and I thought, I'm going to try something. So I have here, this is, and I can tell you what church, I can tell you the year or anything, but this here is a bunch of notes from committee meetings from one year of one of the churches, and I decided I was going to open it up, right? So one that I opened to you, I bookmarked because I just kind of want to read. These are like some notes from these important meetings, right? Let's see. Somebody said, some of the food for BBS has been gotten into. There's no longer a key in the kitchen, but the pantry. Just wanted to bring attention to the fact that we need to be more alert and encourage kitchen users to be honest and not take things from the kitchen. And then, like, the next person was supposed to give a report from her committee, and then all she did, it says on here, the other person who just gave that report said, same as her report. And then somebody, they wanted to fire the maintenance man. Somebody who else, who had some kind of committee, no report. And then there's some stuff about some money that was returned. And then, when's the superintendent going to come see us? And then there's some, there's going to be a list of people sign up for volunteer to usher. Somebody's planning something for next year, and then let's see, the minutes were reviewed and they all adjourned. I would like to say that this report here was sort of the rare occurrence, but I go through all this thing, and you know what all these reports kind of sound like? You know what? Church is boring. Truth is, it doesn't matter what church name this is, and you can put probably any name of a lot of our churches, and it could all be the same stuff in here. Right? And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that every church committee meeting needs to be a circus and there's got to be something, but did y'all hear the passage we just read from John chapter 1? Nathanael becomes a disciple of Jesus on the spot, right? And Jesus says, you think you've seen something now? You think you've found something now? Just you wait. You're going to see greater things than this. I just wonder if the church has gotten used to not seeing greater things. You see, up to this point, in John chapter 1, we've had all kinds of titles of Jesus. Jesus has been called Rabbi. He's been called Messiah. He's been called Son of God. He's been called the one whom Moses talked about. He's been called the King of Israel. John says he's the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world. Jesus himself calls himself the Son of Man. And I think when you and I kind of read this, that kind of gets lost on us. But what John is doing is telling us something, not just about what happened to Jesus along the way to begin his ministry, but he is starting out telling us exactly who we need to understand Jesus is. Son of Man, Son of God, the one whom Moses talked about, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, Messiah, King of Israel. And that these aren't just titles. This is Jesus' mission. And because Jesus understood who he was and what he was called to do by God, he was prepared to be something way more than boring. And that's important for us to consider because, friends, the world is looking, is needing good news. Now, maybe over the last couple weeks, you know, things have gotten way out of hand. They have gotten way out of hand. People need to stop lying to each other. People need to stop thinking the other one is evil. People need to start seeing each other differently. And the church is supposed to be the body of God that shows the world how to do all that. That's great. That's something great. Right? I mean, you see people fighting on the news and, you know, saying stuff like, oh my God, here they go again. Wouldn't it be great to show the world a witness of Jesus? The church is called to something great that I think sometimes we let go of because we're so busy. So much boring stuff. You know what's not in here? Nothing in here about people coming to Christ. Nothing in here about getting more of a church membership into Bible study and prayer. Nothing. That's not in here. Church after church has the same story. Have we forgotten that Jesus tells us there are greater things to look forward to? Yeah, don't get me wrong. There's business we need to attend to. Fixing a gas leak is not all that. Fixing the problems we have here, that needs to be done. But shouldn't that be the stuff that we get done along the way of seeing the great things that God has prepared for us to see? I think so. Maybe we forget that these titles of Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, Lamb of God, Son of Man, they're just titles that tell us who Jesus is. But they're also an invitation. Because we are people that we're called Christians. We take our name after Christ. Christ isn't his last name. It's a title about who he is. And I think maybe a reminder about who we are. As the body of Christ. So, you know, we call ourselves here Methodists. But I don't know if you know, there were other things that people called John Wesley and those other people who followed him, that they called them. Before they called them Methodists, they were called the Holy Club. Right? They were called Bible Moths. Can you see that? Kelsey Memorial. Bible Mile Congregation. But why do you think they call them Bible Moths? I think it's because they kind of threw the Bible around. And been to a church before. One time I heard Bishop Martinez tell a story like that. That's crazy. So I saw it with my own eyes. Went to a church. They had a Bible used to prop something up in the sanctuary. Word of God. It's not a prop. They were called sacramentarians. Because they wanted the sacrament of Holy Communion. Everybody else, they were fine doing it once a month. But Wesley and these other guys said, no, let's find out how we can do this every week. How we can experience the presence of God as much as we can. They were called enthusiasts. Spirit people. Spirit-filled people who got a little too excited about their religion. And then they were called, a word that I always have trouble saying, supererogation men. Amen? Don't amen if you don't know what that means. Essentially, they were accused of doing too much. You know, there's a little bit that you have to do to honor God and to appease God. And any more than that, I mean, come on, who are you trying to impress? And these were all names given to John Wesley and the folks that weren't very nice. These were derogatory things that they were saying. These were ways of poking fun at who they were. And finally, they get to Methodist, right? And that just kind of stuck with us. My point is, if people call you what they know about who you are, don't they? For the most part. Why would people call them the Holy Club or a Bible Mosque? Because that was their priority. I mean, if you were to ask any person you meet outside of the church, who doesn't have a connection of faith, who isn't a part of the church, what do you think they would call us?
Hallelujah.
That's a different talk, isn't it? Yeah. See, the church, we're always fighting with one another, right? Gotta call each other names, right? And the world looks at us and says, I ain't no better than anybody else. And you know what? We are just as boring as everybody else. I think we've talked about this before. People say, well, yeah, man, we're Methodists. That means we love committees and we love potlucks. Don't get me wrong. I love a good potluck. But we are not potluckists or committeeists. And even before we were Methodist, God called us his own. When are we going to remember that? When are we going to say we're tired of the boring stuff and look for the greater things that God has prepared for us? And by greater things, I don't mean that it has to be the next shiny thing. A lot of times the church, okay, we need to start a new program. We got to do a new thing. We need to do this. I'm not talking about the new and the latest fad. I'm talking about understanding who Christ says he is. When he's talking to Nathanael, he says, you know, you're going to see greater things. Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened up and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. If we remember Old Testament scripture, that should bring us back to a story from the Old Testament about angels descending and ascending. Does that bring to your mind any connection to a story? Jacob's ladder, right? Thank you, preacher's wife. Amen. And in that story, Jacob has an experience with God. He realizes that God is in this place. Because in this ladder, whatever this ladder looks like, steps, or whatever it is, he's seen his angels coming back and forth. And it's this vivid picture of the presence of God. He has an experience with God. And part of what I think Jesus is saying is, you're going to see heaven open once again, and you're going to see the angels of God ascending and descending, just like Jacob did in his dream. But this time, it won't be a ladder. I'll be the ladder. You're going to have the experience of God with me. You're going to have the assurance of the presence of God with me, in me. with Christ. What do we call ourselves? Christians. I don't know what that means to you, but part of what it means to me is I am walking with the Creator of the universe. That means that every day has a chance to be something great. Because I am walking with God. I am seeking the presence of God. I am seeking to be in communion with Christ. Christ isn't an afterthought. Christ isn't something that we want to talk about, sing about on Sunday. It's a way that we want to live every day, every moment that we have breath. If that is how we are going to live, we will have these experiences with God as we walk with Christ. And there is nothing boring about that. Praise God. That is the greatest thing. I shared something online this week and said, I want my children to have a boring testimony. See, sometimes we get caught up in sort of the theatrics of some things, and you know, we want to find the person who was lost, and well, they were in prison, and they did all kind of horrible things, and they were this kind of person, and then Jesus turned their life around. We say, that's a testimony. And believe me, friends, that is a testimony. Praise God. Yeah. But you know what else is a testimony? The parents who wake up every Sunday morning, as hard as it is after a long, hard week at work and trying to keep their kids focused in on Zoom learning, trying to do the right thing, to get up on Sunday morning and say, church, we are here with you as a family. We're going to raise our kids to love the Lord. We're going to show them what it means to love God, that they don't have to be the most lost person in the world to have a great testimony. If your testimony is, I woke up with the assurance that I am a child of God, and I took that assurance and I sought after the presence of God, that is a great testimony. But we've got to be willing to do that for it to be a great testimony. But fortunately, sometimes we're content with just being boring. So, what do we do now? How about this? I'm going to ask a question, and you tell me what the response is. What do we do now?
Praying.
Can anything good come from praying?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So, what do we do now? Praise the Lord. Can anything good come from worship? So what do we do now?
Ask the Lord for guidance and listen.
Guidance? Can anything good come from the Holy Spirit's guidance?
Yes.
So what do we do now?
Go out and bring the lost in.
Can anything good come out of evangelism? Funny, we know what we're called to do, don't we? See how easy those answers came out? Sometimes we just rather be boring. And to do the simple, life-giving, great things that God has shown us will lead us to life. So I'm asking you, friends, to not be a boring church. And you want to see those greater things, I want you to pray with me. Almighty God, thank you for the church. Thank you, God, for drawing us together, for not leaving us to have to figure out life on our own, to have to walk through our struggles on our own, to have to find encouragement ourselves. But God, you gave us the church to be your family, your body, in which all of us live and walk with you. For the ways that the church has blessed us, we thank you, Lord. And for the ways that we have failed your church, we ask for your forgiveness. Help us, Lord, to not be boring, but to anticipate the great things that happen when we seek you in your presence, when we set our life to be about walking with Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your Son, in whose name we have strength, power, everlasting life, and in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God. Friends, before we leave, let's take some time to pray together. I'm going to give you a chance as the body to share what you want to pray for, and as you hear those responses, as you hear those prayers, excuse me, response be, Lord, hear our prayer, and once you feel like everyone's done giving whatever it is they want to pray for, anybody that's at home, whatever, they can share what they want to pray for as well. But church, this week, all that's on our minds and our hearts, and all that we're facing, anticipating, what are we praying for this week?
For Tracy, whatever, and also for a peaceful Wednesday.
Lord, hear us.
More violence when the president takes over.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Patricia Trevino.
Lord, hear our prayer. Steve asked for prayers for he and his family. Continue to pray for our Kelsey kids, the work that Pam does with them. Mike asked us to pray for our nation. Pam asked us to pray for our cousins who have the virus. Any others? Let's pray. Almighty God, as we come to you in prayer, we are always grateful. And we know that you want us to pray and that you are willing to listen. And as you teach us to pray to you about the things that are important to us, we know that you also teach us how to see the things that are important to you. As we pray for one another, you will give us compassion and love for each other. That as we learn to pray for our needs, you will also teach us to learn to pray for the needs of others. Somehow in that, us closer together with you and one another. We thank you, Lord, because this time to pray together is a gift from you. We take advantage of these moments and offer to you once again our heart. As we trust you with the things that are important to us, may we also trust you with our lives. And as we come here to worship, as we seek your presence, Lord, we ask that you would fill us with your peace. Your peace is what we need. It's certainly what we need to endure some of these hard seasons, experiences that we go through. It's your peace that we need to find wisdom and strength in hard times. It's even your peace that we need to rattle ourselves out of the boringness that we find ourselves in. It's your peace, God, that brings wholeness to us. So in your mercy, God, as we pray, hear us and bless us with the peace to know that you are with us. And that in Christ we have all the hope we need. And in Christ we have life everlasting. And now, Lord, set us on your way that as we begin to leave this time here of worship, enter to the work you give us to do for your glory in your world. And as we pray, Almighty God, we pray together in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray together as he once taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen, church.
Amen.
Amen. I thank God for each one of you, and I thank God that we are in ministry together. Thank God for the great things that we will be able to see, to do, and experience as we focus all of our lives on the glory of God and the presence of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Before we leave, I'll remind you about our mobile site. We are kelsey.info, whether it's on your computer, on your phone, or what are those things called? Tablets. Sorry, lost the word. You can find us there. We have our daily text message up there. We have our daily devotional. Also, use that for your online giving, which we appreciate. Many of you have. There's also Robert's class. Robert meets. He and I meet Sunday mornings at 9:30. He gives the Sunday school lesson live on our Facebook group. We put it there so everyone can hear and learn together. So we hope you'll make use of that. It's a great tool for us. A simple tool to have. We are kelsey.info. Yes, there it is. That's us. So make use of that. Friends, what a blessing it is to gather in God's name, in God's house, in God's name, with God's people. Amen?
Amen.
I want to ask you to please stand. I want to offer you a benediction. I want to make sure to extend this benediction also to our friends, our church, who are with us online, watching wherever they are. As we begin to leave this place, may we go with the joy of the Lord in our hearts, so that the joy of the Lord can be our strength. Amen?
Amen.
Go now, sisters and brothers, in and with the peace that Christ gives, ready to face the world unafraid, ready to be a blessing to the world, ready for the great things God has prepared for his church. Go now in peace in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks be to God. God be with the church.